Testing, testing. All right, we got a fresh battery now, too.
Yay! I'm happy for myself.
Truth.
Hits everything's cooked.
Brahm, are you going to be taking care of it, or are we now ready to introduce our speaker? All right. If we're all set, come on up and let's hear about the human emotions, which I think I've experienced the entire gamut of in the last 20 minutes.
There you go.
Head up, boy.
Yeah, that's when we usually experience emotions. And the best speeches are done, by the way, at the funeral. I'm not talking yet. It's just like not the presentation.
No mic.
Yeah, no mic yet. This is before the...
What happened?
No, I'm not talking to the mic yet because it's not part of the speech. I got to reach into my pocket.
You need a microphone. Nobody can hear you.
I know.
This is before the speech.
It's like a preliminary. Let's see.
Okay.
Gotta go. I don't want to open up some secrets.
So, can you hear me now?
Yes, we can.
All right. Look at you people. So good to see you. Thank you. Thank you very much for coming. You gotta move back.
Yeah.
For a better headshot.
No, it's
my
because
profile looks sexy.
The glare on the screen, that's why.
I'm good this way, too.
Yes.
Is it good?
Yeah, we're good now.
All right, so welcome to College of Complexes, an amazing place for everyone to be tonight. And those who are not here are cuckoos. They're missing so much, right? What a lively audience I have, right?
Right.
There you go. I mean, if you're here, it means it's important, correct? So therefore, who's not here, it's not important for them, but they don't know what they're missing.
They are missing this. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about myself, too, but I just want you to look at this little picture and, you know, whatever comes to your mind when you look at this picture, I want you to shout it out. Come on, shout out one or two words. Go.
Purple heart.
Weird picture.
What else?
A key.
Burning heart.
The guy with a crew cut.
Yeah. The guy with a crew cut. When you look at this heart, you see a guy with a crew cut?
Yeah.
No, this is a guy with a crew cut right here.
Is that like a Rorschach test?
It's the devil looking into your brain.
There you go. It's the devil. It looks like the devil's thingies, right? Whatever it is. Yeah, horns. All right, anyway. So, unlock your emotions, unlock your potential is the topic of the speech I did a couple months ago, and I just decided to name it differently. All right, but recently I have become involved with Right Foundation for the Realization of Human Potential. It's Dr. Bob and Judith Wright. They are the founders of this. It's a graduate university right now, a non-credit course program in Chicago. And they blew my mind about 2 years ago, and I thought I knew something. Now I'm sure I know nothing, okay? And I'm definitely, you know, ready to share with you how much nothing I know, all right? And I hope you will share with me your nothing. Okay, so emotional intelligence. What do we know about emotional intelligence? Anyone, tell me. What is it? Go ahead.
It's pretty dumb.
Pretty dumb.
I think Daniel Goleman might have written a book first about that, a psychologist. There's a book called Emotional Intelligence.
All right, Daniel Goleman wrote a book about it. Excellent. Ooh. Can emotions and food mix?
Sure.
Yeah, they actually mix in a very unhealthy way. I'll tell you more about it if you ask me.
Okay.
All right, that's it. Anybody else? Emotional intelligence. What comes to mind? What do you know about it?
We don't normally get it measured like IQ is measured.
All right, gotcha. Yeah, we do actually now.
I guess if we read, you know, like we self-education more we read, the more it's intelligent.
Okay, so the more we read, the lady's saying, the more we read, the more we get emotionally intelligent or something, the more we learn about it, right? Good. Okay.
Self-awareness.
Increase our self-awareness. Good. I like it. Okay. So whatever comes to mind, right, is what you have right now in your head about emotional intelligence, right? So, recently, corporations started looking at humans' EQ, emotional quotient, rather than IQ, because they have been realizing that it is more important that their organization run based on this rather than IQ. Do you guys know some intelligent people that have no social skills? Raise your hand if you do. All right, very good. So how long do they usually stay at the job? Not very long, right? They don't get along, you know, and stuff, and blah, and blah, and blah, and blah, and blah, okay? So people started investing into it, and that's why now with the advance in neuroscience and all this, you know, technological advances, we can now look inside our brain and start seeing that Freud was right. You know, that the ancient philosophers were thinking about something that is today proven by science what we are built like, okay? So I was really intrigued because since very, very childhood, I'm going to sing a song about it even, I was interested in what's going on. You know, who created all those things, you know, like, what's up, you know, why do people cry, why do they laugh, you know, why people are obviously hiding what's inside them, what's the problem, why can't they do that, you know? But then I was socialized, especially in the socialist country, you get socialized really well, you know, so I was taught to feel a certain way, behave a certain way, but I felt something was wrong, that's why I'm in America now, you know, because I had a chance to catch that boat, you know. And I'm enjoying it. I've been in America for 20 years now, almost. You know, and I enjoyed every single moment of it. You know, I love it. Thank you very much. You guys have created a great country for me to come to. Thank you very much.
Where'd you come from?
I came from the Soviet Union, one of the republics called Belarusia. So you could remember my name, Sasha from Belarusia.
Huh? This way, I thought it was Belarus.
Okay. So deep inside my heart, and I hope you do, I feel that we are all one. That's what I feel, and now I found a lot of literature actually saying that.
And I'm disagreeing.
And you, of course, will disagree, because we are not all one. Because we're all individuals, individuated into our own separate entities. Nevertheless, we could be one if we choose to. And I will not go into, I'm not going to prove it to you. You could disagree with me all you want, actually love it. But I'm gonna do what I'm doing, okay? So,
okay.
My story. I'm gonna run it quickly. As I said, I was born in the Soviet Union, raised by a single mom. My dad left, found a better place, but you know, was paying child support very well, and I remember him from good sides too, okay? And then I went through the Soviet education, got my high school diploma, got my college degree, and then Soviet Union broke apart, you know, and my music major was not very needed. You know, people needed to put bread on the table.
What was your major?
My major was orchestra conducting, all right, and I did conduct the orchestra once at the finals, and that was the end of my orchestra conducting, all right. But I wanted to play music, I wanted to be seen, I will talk about it a little more. I wanted people to see me for what I am, how special I was, and all that stuff. And being a rock star seemed like a good idea. Alright, so I started playing music. My father is a musician, my mom is a ballerina. You know, so I was always surrounded by people, you know, of art. You know, actually when I was a little baby, my mom didn't have a babysitter, so she would take me to Bolshoi of Belarus and tie me up to the bench next to the stage, and I would just, you know, so I don't run out and start asking her for things in the middle of, you know, the play or whatever it was, ballet. So I listened to a lot of music subconsciously. My implicit memories are filled with it. All right, so every time I stop talking, I'm playing music, usually drums. All right, so then when the Soviet Union collapsed, I a lot of influences from the West, Rotten West we called it. You guys heard that expression? Rotten West. You know, our ideology was at stake. You know, we were given those lectures, if you listen to heavy metal rock for 20 minutes you will die and stuff like this. I remember that in school. You know, sexual education became popular because kids were uneducated about it. You know, and drugs and sex and rock and roll moved in real fast, along with Jesus. You know, on every corner. And I remember we had a palace of chess and checkers filled with Jesus people running around suddenly, you know. So, but most of the country was skeptical about all that stuff, you know. Like, what's going on? What, Jesus? We lived without you for 70 years. It's okay, you know. But deep inside, I felt like there was something bigger than me, you know. And I guess I kept looking for it all the time. And when my friends introduced some interesting, you know, substances that we all know about it, I decided to check it out and started going certain ways. But it turned out to be a dead end. All right. As much as I was trying to reach to that power and get special powers for myself to control the universe or whatever, I don't know what you were dreaming about, you know, I almost died in the process of looking for this thing. And thank God, you know, somehow I'm here today. And I'm thankful for my existence every day, and I try to share my, you know, my love for living with everyone. All right? So in the United States, I went to college, started pursuing my music career, and drove a taxi for about 5 years. Learned English real fast. If you go to a new country, start driving a cab. I guarantee your language will pick up real fast, along with learning how to drive, too. You know, in Russia, we didn't have enough cars for everyone. You know, so anyway, after I realized that I cannot go this way, you know, with a substance on my right shoulder, you know, or left shoulder, I asked for help, and I received this help through a 12-step fellowship, and a lot of opened up for me, a lot of things opened up for me. I started being able to actually think straight and remember what happened yesterday. It's important. And about, so I haven't used any mind-altering substances for more than 10 years now. And 2 years ago, I was introduced to this emotional intelligence way of life. And, you know, if some of you have gotten your heart and you rely on your higher power, if you call it Jesus or Trinity, whatever, you know that if something bad happens, you go for God. You know, I do, because my emotions overwhelmed me so much that they only knew one answer, you know, to check out, whichever way possible. And I still think this way, you know. The only thing that changed is that my routines and behaviors changed, all right? And largely due to me learning about myself and my emotional intellect, all right? So I'm going to introduce to you what I learned in the Wright Foundation in the past 2 years. I'm a student there right now in their program called Year of Transformation. It's a non-credit program, but if you have a bachelor's degree, you're welcome to join their graduate university, all right? And it's an amazing school that makes it different from other schools in one aspect. Nobody graduates if you don't do what you learn. So it's called experiential learning, and this makes the world of a difference, you know. And there's no paper I will write, you know, if I didn't experience that. As a matter of fact, they don't check your grammar. Wow, amazing, right? Isn't that great? So it's a new way of education, and maybe not very new for the world, but it's been working in many people's lives, and I've seen lives of people transform. And I see it still every day, including my own. And usually somebody else tells me about me changing before I see it. All right? So, I'm here to tell you this. What are you here for? Anybody? In this room, obviously, to eat and listen, right? In this city for various reasons, right? But on this planet, anybody, shout out. Why are you here on this planet? Anybody?
I don't know.
Speak for yourself. Speak for yourself. Go ahead.
I'll tell you why, because my parents got married.
Your parents got married. Okay, good. His parents got married.
The conditions were right. We were lucky the conditions were right.
The conditions were right. That's why we're on this plan. Good. Okay. Somebody else? Go ahead, sir.
I'm trying to live the most meaningful life.
Meaningful life for a meaning. Good. Okay.
Well, now I've got to love
To glorify God forever. Beautiful. Yes, sir.
This is the only habitable planet that we know of in the two of
them. Yeah, so hey, no other planets to choose from, so we're here.
Yeah.
Cool. Anybody else?
Out of Ecclesiastes, to fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the soul, for this is the sum of the whole existence of man. Right at the end on this, where Solomon says his final words of wisdom.
So it's related somehow to the word of God. Is that what you're saying?
Basically,
amen.
Yes.
Amen to this.
Amen, brother.
Okay. Or amin, we say it in Russian and Arabic, no? Yes. Mm-hmm. Very good. So, we're in the right place then. Okay, and we cannot leave this planet. just as much as you cannot leave this body immediately, right? Oh, sorry. What are you here for? All right. For a Coke? All right. So, I want to show you something to bring you back to your childhood. All right? I just want you to watch this video and reflect as far back as when you were one. All right? Let's see if this video works.
And it still takes its turn. What the mother did was she sits down and she's playing with her baby who's about a year of age.
And was girl. Oh.
And she gives a greeting to the baby. The baby gives a greeting back to her.
Yeah.
This baby starts pointing at different places in the world, and the mother's trying to engage her and play with her. They're working to coordinate their emotions and their intentions, what they want to do in the world. And that's really what the baby is used to. And then we ask the mother to not respond to the baby.
To go coffee.
The baby very quickly picks up on this, and then she uses all of her abilities to try and get the mother back. She smiles at the mother. She points because she's used to the mother looking where she points. The baby puts both hands up in front of her and says, "What's happening here?" She makes that screechy sound at the mother, like, "Come on, why aren't we doing this?" Even in this 2 minutes, when they don't get the normal reaction, they react with negative emotions, they turn away, they feel the stress of it, they actually may lose control of their posture because of the stress that they're experiencing.
So how do you feel about it? What feelings did you guys have just right now watching this?
Mixed feelings.
Mixed feelings, good.
Uncomfortable,
good. What else? Amazed?
It was a mean experiment.
Mean experiment, yes, yes, very good. What else? Go ahead, sir.
Memories of my daughter.
Yes, very good. Memories of my daughters. So were you able to travel back in your life and remember yourself when you were one? Probably not all the way. You know, we cannot do that. There's a part of our brain that develops around age of five that allows you to remember those things. But some people can remember it because it was recorded somewhere. Yeah, some remember 3 years old, some two. Yeah, but one is pretty deep because it's before that part of the brain developed, right? But guess what? Since the moment you're conceived, you're already accumulating knowledge about this world. And when you come out and you start learning about it, it's already happening. It's called implicit memory, it's pre-language, and it's real. The interesting thing about the babies is that everything the baby sees by the age of seven, everything the baby feels by the age seven, experiences, touches, sounds, smells, all that is ingrained forever into our so-called matrix, all right? Our combination of memories and neurons in the brain get together, fire together, and stay together forever. Unlike other cells in our body, neurons are the only cells that do not die. So right now, this very moment, if you remember yourself at one, you still have the same neurons. Some of them were created later on, but the majority of them is what you call yourself, yourself. All right, and most of it is not the language. Most of it is emotions. That's why learning about emotions is super important. Dr. Jill Bolte-Taylor, has anybody heard of Dr. Jill Bolte-Taylor? Had an opportunity to study her brain. She is a neural anatomist. She studies brain for a living for many years. She had a stroke some years back, and she was able to experience her brain work from inside when her left brain disconnected. You know, we have two brains, right? They are not connected in the middle. You know, usually we see a picture with two hemispheres. I was shocked that they're not even connected in the middle, which actually she said means that these two brains have two different personalities, really. One brain, the right brain, if you know computers, acts like a parallel processor. This brain takes all the information in every second, a lot of information, and thinks in pictures, and is in here and now. And it creates this enormous collage, she says, of how this present moment feels like, looks like, smells like, right? And this brain is in here and now, okay? It's constantly here, 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 here. So imagine yourself being in here all the time. How would you look? I think you would look like this, probably like that. Because they're so beautiful. It's way too much information for us to process. So God or whatever, the nature or Charles Darwin and his friends created the left brain. The left brain is acting like a serial processor. So it starts picking up information from the right brain and creates a story, weaves a story as a serial processor. So you cannot actually do two things at the same time. All right? So when people multitask, they don't. They actually quickly switch between the activities. So I don't suggest you multitask, by the way, especially if it's something important. All right? So, the brain has developed over millions of years. And an interesting thing, I'm going to talk about emotions and spirituality if I can today. When the baby is growing from the little seed, right? The first neurons are formed in the area where our heart later is. So basically, then we say, speak from your heart. It actually makes perfect sense biologically. You know, that the first neurons were in our heart. So it makes sense to think, you know, that somehow we do speak from the heart. It's not just an expression. Okay, it has some meaning to it. And everybody will find the meaning for themselves. All right? But what she explains, right, is that the way we perceive information from the world comes approximately of, well, let's just say I simplified it. I'm not an artist, obviously, you can see that, but I simplified it for you, right? We receive, this is our spinal cord, right? This is the side of the brain, right? This is our frontal lobe, the higher intelligence of the brain. Okay, it's right here. When we receive the information, when information comes into our brain, through some 300 million fibers, it doesn't go and get stored in your memory first. It goes to your limbic brain, okay? And that brain is basically your emotional center, okay? That decides what's important emotionally and what's not, like the baby, what the baby did, okay? And if it's important, then it chooses this information and stores it in your memory, all right? The good thing about the brain, though, is that even though we cannot change our matrix, the first 7 years of our foundational brain, it has neural plasticity. The neurons can still change the connections, which means the brain you come in today with, you will probably leave with a different brain. Okay, it's up to you to exercise the new knowledge and keep the electricity running through those circuits, or just do something and revert to your old 7-year-old baby way of life. Okay, so it's up to us to practice anything, and in order to, say, get a skill like guitar playing, you got to put in like 10,000 hours, you know, to become good at something. So guess what? If you don't like the way your brain thinks, you know, you got to practice 10,000 hours in order to change that. Otherwise, the brain is very economical. It only has 40 watts of electricity to run on. So if you don't practice the thoughts that you got now, it's going to take this electricity and put it somewhere else. It's more important, okay? So, good thing about it is that you, now knowing this information, can tell your brain something and make a loop. Tell the brain, I am happy when you're sad. It will create the emotion and the chemicals in your brain that will trigger the whole body response, and you will actually feel better by saying something, all right? And this circle loop will create a good connection for at least a couple minutes, I believe, that will stay there, and unless you don't, you know, unless you practice it, it's gonna go away. But, you see, we got a chance. We got a chance to change our emotions from childhood. You know, I was crying every day from age 6 to age 12. My teenage brother was growing up, and my mom and I were arguing, right? My mom and him were arguing all the time, and I was in the middle of that, crying for an hour every day because I was put in the middle of this fight, blamed for being the mama's boy and everything. So it's pretty deep. It's pretty deep hurt inside me. But then when I grew up, you know, started smoking weed, I forgot about it. You know, oops, what did I say? Weed. Got it out. Okay, but the point is, it was a lot of hurt that I experienced and then forgot about, you know? So my job is now to retrain myself to start feeling. Okay, this is how, what's gonna happen if you don't practice your new ideas, new math formulas, you know, whatever new skill you learn. The matrix eaters will eat the new foundation, you know, and you will revert back to your old matrix. Okay, well, of course, it's much more complicated than that, but you have the power to retrain and create on top of what you have, new memories and new ideas using your emotions. You know, if I tell you something really cool and you're not emotionally related to it, it's gonna go bye-bye, unfortunately. No matter how interesting it sounds, during the lecture, people forget 95% of it by the next day, if they don't practice it or teach others. Okay, so I strongly suggest if you get something for yourself today, go and share it with your dog, cat, or friend. All right, somebody. It has to be you using your higher consciousness and bringing the electricity to your language center in order to reinforce the knowledge that you guys have. All right? So, how do we know what we want in life? How do you know? Why do you choose this cell phone over that cell phone? Eggs and bacon over the cereal? Do you know what causes it? Logic or emotion?
Emotion.
Thank you very much. I have a good audience. Okay, I can go. Thanks. Bye. Okay, so absolutely. Absolutely. So these emotions, so basically just like a computer, we have software and the hardware. The hardware comes with this development of the brain over centuries and millennia, right? Something that we always will want to be. When the baby is born, it already has preloaded memories of those who were before us, and before us, and before them, and before them. And then on top of it, we record more information, all right? So that's why everybody is so individualized. It's so cool, you know? Nobody is the same, even though biologically, guess how similar you and me are? How similar are we biologically? Somebody.
About the same.
Do you know what about means in your language?
Pretty much, almost 100%.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much for bringing this information out. You and me are 99.99% biologically the same. Therefore, biologically, we want the same things. And we call those things yearnings. I'm inviting you to use the word yearnings today. What is a yearning, somebody?
Desire. What else?
Longing.
I love that. You wanted to say longing?
Hunger for something.
Yes, very good. An urge or something, right? So, yeah. So these are the yearnings that we found, and I found in myself, and learning it at Right Foundation, are the yearnings that we all share. Unlike once, right? You might want a bacon and eggs, and I might want a cereal for breakfast. But these things we all want, and yearnings are the things that will make you happy. Anybody want to be happy here?
No,
right? Sarcastic people cannot say yes. It's in your brain. It's in your matrix. You know, you got to act on that. All right? And everybody is individual this way. But if you think about this yearning, if you look at this, this is what I should be doing all day long. You know, follow my yearnings. Okay? And that's where the emotional intelligence comes, right? I have to start saying, okay, why do I not say what I mean to say to this person? Right? What stops me from that? My yearning is to tell him the freaking truth. You know, he's an idiot or something, you know? But something stops me, all right? Society, anything. You could find billions of reasons, right? But in order for me to become emotionally intelligent, I need to become a warrior of emotions. Find what runs me. What yearning is underneath my desire to do something? All right, and I guarantee if you start following your yearnings, you will be much more fulfilled and happy. Okay, because as you know, things don't make you happy. As a matter of fact, 1 hour is the average time that material object makes you happy for. Okay, so, hey, how many material things can you get to stay happy all the time this way? But if you satisfy your yearning, if you get an experience in life, experiences last much longer, all right? And it's not the money sometimes, it's lifestyle we yearn for, okay? So, okay, let's look at this video of one comedian that I love very much, so I put his little clip right here, because he's gonna tell you about his experience with allowing emotion to pass through him, okay? So let's check it out.
You know, I think these things are toxic. I don't, especially for kids. It's just this thing. It's bad. And right, they don't look at people when they talk to them, and they don't build the empathy. You know, kids are mean, and it's because they're trying it out. They look at a kid, and they go, "You're fat." And then they see the kid's face scrunch up, and they go, "Ooh, that doesn't feel good to make a person do that." Right. But they got to start with doing the mean thing. But when they write, "You're fat," then they just go,
That's a cell phone text.
So, that tasted good. Yeah, exactly. You need to build an ability to just be yourself and not be doing something. That's what the phones are taking away.
Yes.
Is the ability to just sit there like this. That's being a person, right?
Yes.
No one can, they gotta, you gotta check. Because, you know, underneath everything in your life, there's that thing, that empty, forever empty. You know what I'm talking about?
Yes, I know what you're talking about.
Just that knowledge that it's all for nothing and you're alone. You know, it's down there. And sometimes when things clear away, you're not watching it, and you're in your car, and you start going, "Oh, no, here it comes, that I'm alone," like it starts to visit on you. You know, just the sadness.
Yes.
Life is tremendously sad just by, you know, being in it. And so you're driving, and then you go, that's why we text and drive. I look around, pretty much 100% of people driving are texting.
Yes.
And they're killing, everybody's murdering each other with their cars.
Yes.
But people are willing to risk taking a life and ruining their own because they don't want to be alone for a second because it's so hard. I was in my car one time, and a Bruce Springsteen song comes on. And I heard it, and it gave me kind of like a fall back to school depression feeling. It made me really sad.
Yeah.
And I go, okay, I'm getting sad. I've got to get the phone and write hi to like 50 people. And then, you know, somebody cool writes back, and then somebody not as cool writes after, and I'm like, oh, you know, I got somebody better. I started to get that sad feeling, and I was reaching for the phone, and I said, you know what, don't. Just be sad. Just let the sadness, just stand in the way of it, and let it hit you like a truck. And I let it come, and Bruce, and I just started to feel, oh my God. And I pulled over, and I just cried like a bitch. I cried so much, and it was beautiful. It was like this beautiful, it's just this sadness is poetic. You're lucky to live sad moments. And then I had happy feelings because when you let yourself feel sad,
yes,
your body has like antibodies. It has happiness that comes
rushing in
to meet the sadness. So I was grateful to feel sad, and then I met it with true, profound happiness. It was such a trip, you know. And the thing is, because we don't want that first bit of sad, we push it away with like a little phone for the food, and you get a little kind of. You never feel completely sad or completely happy. You
right.
just feel kind of satisfied with your product.
Yes.
And then you die. So that's why I don't want to get a phone from my kids. That's what I'm going to do.
All right. So do you know the guy? No. Louis C.K. Yeah, Louis C.K. And this is his daughters. He didn't want to give them the phone. And this is his explanation of it. So a lot of information so far. Is that true? Maybe most of you knew that, and you knew most of it, but it's a lot of information. So let's just digest it quickly, right? I want you to find a partner right now, around the table, okay? Just one person, you know, and then digest it by thinking more or less creatively about what happened. So what struck you from what I have said or what you have just seen in this video, right? And how it struck you, and what are the implications of it for your life, right? And what long-term influence could this thinking or feeling or doing have? Okay, so find a partner right now. If you don't have a partner, raise your hand. Okay, go ahead, just, you know, meet the eyes, and I'm gonna have you do something very interesting. Hold on, let's not talk yet. Let's not talk yet. Just one, find a partner. Don't talk about it yet. What I'm going to do is I'm going to accelerate our learning. You're going to do something that you haven't done before. You will listen while your partner talks. Okay, the person with the long hair in your pair will be person A, okay, and the shorter hair will be person B. So you'll only have 1 minute to express everything you have heard and answer these four questions. After the minute, you will shut up and will create a space for the second person who will just speak to hear him or herself talking. So it's not a discussion, it's you talking to yourself with a partner, okay? Do you understand? Do I have to explain it?
Can't see the four questions.
Okay, I already told you. Just what struck you and how you can use it in life. That's it. You have 1 minute to share with your partner. Partner, do everything possible not to say anything. You could do this. Like this, right? But do not start a conversation in the usual sense of it. Okay? Who does not have a partner? Okay, everybody has a partner and some don't participate, so you'll be just chilling for 2 minutes. Okay, so person A, go. Person B, listen.5 seconds for person A. Okay, person A, stop talking. Person B, begin to talk. Person A, listen. Go.
You can't keep up with these animals. Well, I can say the other thing I pick up from this is the texting. You know, like at one point he pointed out. Like,
you don't have a partner?
You can cause an accident. Right? You know, take your mind off the road, worry with the cell phone. And you got to worry about that. Minute of emotion that you can't wait. You can ruin your life or take somebody else's life. Which is an important fact that I can recall at the moment. That's the long term feeling I get out of it.
All right, time is up. Guess what? If you want to talk a little more, grab each other after. Okay? But this is called accelerated learning. Learning something, learning to say something in a short period of time so you keep the story out and only bottom line what really makes sense to you. Okay? So you begin to learn to use your time the right way. You know, because we love telling stories. This, as a matter of fact, is the sole job of our left brain, to tell yourself a story of your life. All right, and if you keep listening to the story without changing it, guess what? You will have what you always had. Nothing will change. 90% of things we do, you know, today, we did them yesterday. All right, so tell me what struck you guys quickly. Just whoever wants to share, raise your hand. What struck you most? Go ahead.
Give her the mic, will you?
Okay. Okay.
Can you repeat what you just said?
Yeah, I will. I definitely will. This is the whole point, right? Of me having the mic. Yeah. So you're saying you're learning to drive, right?
And be. No, I'm driving.
Yes. Exactly, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So you're learning to drive to any place and not be totally panicked, right? Going to unknown places, good. Anybody else, what struck you?
All right, I'm coming.
Or what stroked you? Anybody? Go ahead, sir.
Well, being older than my partner, I thought of this more, and actually having emotional problems made me really focus on this subject more than the average person. So I haven't read Emotional Intelligence. I wish I could read all the books that I'd love to read, but I've been thinking about it for a while. And I'm aware of how, let's say, some people in politics are not demonstrating a lot of maturity.
That's what you were talking about?
I told my partner, maybe this is just packaging it in a different way, but it's maturity. That word, which has been around a long time, has to do with, you know, if you're emotionally intelligent, you're mature. And I think they're pretty much synonymous.
Very good. Thank you. Thank you very much. So the bottom line here is emotional intelligence is your maturity. Good. Interesting. Very good. Anybody else? Nothing struck you, huh? All right, well, I'll take it as you don't want to share it yet, but one day you will, correct? Okay, no problem. Just take it in for now. Take it in for now, and I'm sure everybody has an opinion about it, right? Great. So, nice. You're feeling better, closer. It's okay, don't worry about it. One little thing at a time. We're gonna build incrementally. Yeah, it's okay. Don't tell yourself this story anymore and you see what's gonna happen. When we say, I have done it many times, oh, it never worked before, guess what? You're denying yourself an opportunity to try again and change your brain. Okay, don't worry about it. I'm scared too. I'm scared right now. No, we're like, oh, what's wrong with these guys? Oh my God, they're not talking to me. Oh, maybe I'm not saying something right. Oh my God, it's a failure. Oh, all those thoughts are always running in the back. Don't worry about it. We're all in the same boat, okay? So trust me, you're not different. We just didn't learn how to express ourselves yet, okay? Saying the words like, I'm scared, is not what society was teaching us, you know what I mean? Or I'm hurt. Or I'm angry, even those words, you know, in our families and, you know, places where we grew up, some things were not customary, okay? So, are you guys ready for the new and the main information, the main what you call it, course of our restaurant here? Okay, so, as I said before, these first 7 years of life are formational years. We must have it. Nobody had perfect parents, you understand that? Nobody had perfect childhood, but we had to go through what we had to go through in order to acquire this understanding of this universe, the way we see it today. Now, it's our job to transform. So the first 7 years were formational. Now, it's up to us to transform and have transformational years of life. In our school, we say it's never too late to have a happy childhood. All right? So what makes us us? All right? And I believe that we have to look at these first 7 years, especially the first 2 years of our lives, okay? So according to Dr. Bob and Judith Wright, and of course they got it from somewhere and adapted it, with the knowledge is always in the space, right? We have always been moving from the state of pain in our life to the state of pleasure, okay? And the emotions that we formed, you know, in order to experience life fully are very few, as a matter of fact. And if you could guess by the empty spaces, how many emotions do we have? How many? Guess?
Five.
Oh my God, somebody guessed it. Maybe she knew. Yes, we have five emotions and they are formed in the early years of life, okay? When the baby is born, like before the baby is born, you're sitting in your baby's mama, in the mama's stomach, right? You're right there. Everything is quiet, nice. You don't have to breathe. You don't have to chew. Everything is fine and beautiful and quiet. And then suddenly the waters break, right? And you're being pulled through this tiny channel and they pull you out and they raise you in the foreign, you know, air. And in order for you to breathe, they do what? pow, they slap you. So what do you feel? What kind of world are you just entering? What kind of emotions you think dominates us all, because it's forever recorded into our neurons, right? Rude awakening, right? So the emotion the baby experiences first 6 months of its life is fear, okay? And fear is always there because we do need it to avoid the running truck. You know, oh, you don't want to stand and say, oh, there's a truck coming at me. Oh, it's blue. Oh, it's going really fast. You'd be dead already, right? So your emotions, and as I show you, remember the limbic system shuts down the frontal lobe and says, run. And it works about 100 times faster than the frontal lobe, okay? So this fear is necessary. The problem is that we create so many fears with the left brain that we freeze and never try to see what will really happen if we do something, okay? So acknowledging your fear and saying, I'm scared, works magic. So I want everybody to say, I'm scared. Aren't you scared to say I'm scared? All right. So just saying this, you know what you just did? You went from the fear that runs you to the language center, and you brought up online, back online, your frontal lobe. So you begin to think rationally instead of doing stupid things like getting divorced or something. Okay? You can actually start saying what you feel and analyze it using your frontal lobe. Okay? So every time you're scared, please don't blame people for that, because it's you, your emotions, okay? Be responsible for them first. Now, from 6 months to a year and a half, the baby started crawling, understood that the mom is going to be there, whoever gives care, right? So it starts exploring. It can crawl now. Look at that thing, and it starts going. Oh, wow, power outlet. The babies, by the way, see their energy. You know, so they see most of the stuff we don't see anymore, okay? And the job of the mom is to save the baby, because the baby's going to get killed or burned by the stove. So every 7 minutes on the average baby is said, no, no, no. And the baby does not have a frontal lobe to judge whether it's good or bad, so it just hears it. And no doesn't sound very encouraging when there's some big, big, big creature, your mom, and you're a little baby, right, is up against one another. So the baby is powerless and it feels hurt. Yes, that's the second emotion that we always hear. We always feel, I'm sorry. Guess what? You still feel this emotion. You're on the elevator. You come in. Your morning is beautiful. You come and there's a person in the elevator and you say, hi! And the person goes, you just got hurt. Yeah. But you suppressed it so fast that you didn't give a hurt a chance to flow through your body as it's supposed to be. Do you see the babies that suppress their emotions? No, they fully express. And this is the whole point, all right, to express your emotions fully. So by the age 2, the baby realizes that it doesn't have to listen to the mother. It's going to save her, or she's going to save her anyway. So it develops the most popular emotion to cover up for fear and hurt. And guess what it is? What do people do when we hurt them?
Anger.
Yay, they get angry because this is the way to avoid discomfort of being scared or hurt. So anger is the emotion that the baby begins. Terrible twos, that's why they're called terrible twos. You go back here. The baby doesn't do anything because it knows the mom is not going to kill the baby, you know what I mean? So they keep exploring and they say no. They start learn to say no to the parents. So these are the three emotions, and as you can see, I connected them, right? You remember, every time you feel angry, there is usually a hurt or a fear underneath it. And if you admit to yourself that you're angry, first I'm angry, then you look for the reason. Oh, because I'm hurt, they're stealing my time. Or I'm afraid I won't be able to get what I want. Then you use your higher consciousness and you're able to use the anger to drive you to pleasure. Otherwise, you just use the anger to suppress your hurt and fear. So anger is like a transitional emotion. You can use it for creation or destruction, okay? Because do you know people who get angry longer than 90 seconds and stay angry? Yeah, you know what they're doing? They keep reactivating the circuit because this is the familiar emotion that makes them feel good for a while, okay? And have their system stay the same because nobody wants to disturb the system. Once system is set in place, your brain has an amygdala, a special police that watches for threats every second of your life. watching every second, every second, every second. So whatever disturbs your system is a threat to it, okay? So it tells it to react, to run away, to do it, okay? So it's up to us to bring the higher consciousness in and say, oh, it's not anger, it's a hurt. And what can I do about this hurt? I can do this, this, and this. I have to step into unknown and try what happens.
Rather than just being
stuck in fear.
Okay. Fist. Keep it a little farther away. It'll
work. Oh, like this? You think it's better
about
this way?
A fist way would be the best way to do it.
Oh, like that?
No, just hold it about a fist away.
About this much, right?
A little more.
Like that?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Can you guys hear?
Yeah.
All right,
yeah.
Cool. Yeah, maybe it overloads. Okay. Got it. So, the higher level emotions are sadness. That's what Louis C.K. talked about it. And the sadness is what? It's actually absence of pleasure. And then the higher level emotion than that is a joy. So, traditionally, that's yummy. Traditionally, we were taught to treat these four emotions as negative emotions and to avoid them. But just like Louis C.K. said, honey, he was calling you. But now, if you want to have real joy in life, guess what? We have to learn to accept all of them. Because if you never feel completely sad, you never feel completely happy. If you don't tell yourself you're scared, you'll never reach the pleasure. Okay? And I guarantee from my experience, I've tried it several times and it works. And my homework, as a matter of fact, is to go and experience hurt. 2 weeks ago, I had this assignment, you know, and I did it. And then I felt so great when I came and reconnected. Remember the baby, the video? It's okay that the baby is not seen by the mother all the time. As a matter of fact, it's bad if baby is pampered too much. Okay, when the baby grows up and there is no mother, baby is in distress and depressed and uses medicine. And we have 67 million Ambiens filled out a couple of years back, right? And half of the Americans are using medication of some sort, okay? So the good part of it is coming back to the baby. And the best ratio is about 30 to 70. So the baby should be seen about 30% of the time with love, unconditionally and with positive regard. And this way the baby is really well formed. Okay, that's ideal, of course. So if you research your childhood, you will find out whether you got enough attention or not enough, and that's what governs you. That's how much hurt you have. That's how much fear of unknown you have. Okay? And that's how much anger you develop to cover up those emotions. All right? So I'm inviting you to start, you know, feeling what you're feeling and acknowledging having this, because without emotion, there is no memory. Okay? And if you want to remember, for example, where you left your keys, right? Who leaves keys and cannot find them? Or your phone? Raise your hand. Okay, all you need to do is to create a crazy movie, for example, right? I'm going to put my phone right there, but I'm going to imagine that a big spider is going to grab me. And I just created the fear, okay? And then I'm going to go do my stuff, and when I say, where's my keys? I'm going to remember the spider and the fear, and I'm going to go and find it, all right? Whatever you want to do.
You have to wait for the...
Just wait a little bit. Write it down. Okay? So, five emotions only. If somebody says, I'm embarrassed, what are they feeling?
Hurt.
They feel these three together in a different combination. They're scared, right? They're angry that they cannot do anything about it. They're hurt because, you know, they cannot change the situation. And they're afraid that their image has been intruded. Okay? So all the names like annoying, embarrassed, uncomfortable, it's all combination of these five foundational emotions. So the language has become real simple, people. You see that? Make it simple. Simplify your life. It works with me when I say I'm hurt to my son. I was really scared to say, because I'm angry at my teenagers. I have two teenagers and an 11-year-old in the house. It's not easy to live with those kind of people, you know, but I got to. So I was really afraid to tell my middle one, you know, that he annoys me and drives me crazy. But then my people, you know, my classmates and my teachers told me, so why are you angry with him? Where's the fear? Where's the hurt? And I said, yeah, I'm afraid to lose control over him. And I'm hurt that over and over he doesn't do what I tell him to do. I believe that's right and he doesn't do it. And they say, why don't you tell him that? I'm like, wow, I got really scared. How can I tell a teenager that I'm afraid to lose the control? You know? But I did practice it with my friends, and I went and I grabbed my son, and I said to him, Stefan, I want to tell you, I am really scared to lose control over you. You know, I love you very much, but it hurts. I feel hurt when you don't do when I tell you to put the socks away, right? And stuff like this. I would really love, you know, us to be closer together and be real, you know? He hugged me. A teenager hugging a parent is not a very common sight, you know? And then we went for family therapy a couple of weeks later, and the therapist asked, so guys, my children, right? Who do you think is your dad's favorite? And he raised his hand. And I could never connect to him before. It was always arguing, okay? He is much more intelligent right now. He went through the training that I will tell you about at the end, okay? And we now talk about our feelings. 10 minutes? Mm-hmm. Very good. So, what do you guys think about it?
Just tell me.
What you think about this information? Is that useful?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's interesting. I wonder how much it costs to learn.
Okay, well, it could cost you nothing. For 2 years I was there just learning about it. But if you want to really get in depth and start rematrixing your thinking, then yes.
It's the same thing I've been experiencing at a small group Bible study with a book called Soul Detox, where it's talking about, you know, getting the emotions up.
Very
and
good.
Then bringing them to the surface, and then finding out what's driving you inside, and then trying to repent of it and find a better behavior.
That's right.
For it.
Subconsciously, the humanity has known this information all the time. Now we just have enough neuroscience to prove that it's right. And really, what society teaches us, you know, is to keep our false self up so we don't get hurt or scared as much.
The one...
One second.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
What do you think about integrative medicine?
Just think...
Connected to
your... Yeah. So let's talk about it a little later, right? So, obviously, for me, it's like... a bottomless, you know, place where I could go and learn more and more about myself. And I'm just in the beginning, and I keep a beginner's mind. Go ahead, sir.
Yeah, I just want to mention, you know, you talked about one of the fears, emotions being fear.
Mm-hmm.
And fear has an acronym. False evidence
appearing real. Yes, false evidence appearing real. Thank you for sharing that. This is beautiful. Most of the time it's false. It's just your left brain projection of what's possible, but it doesn't mean it will be real. The brain, left brain's job is to take all the information you've collected from before and project all the possible futures. Most of the time, we choose the worst future and choose to not act. Okay, but those of us, those few of us who step into that fear and do it, they usually win the lottery. And by lottery, I mean anything they want in their lives because they follow their yearnings. All right, so, would you like to hear a song?
Yes.
Yes, no, by show of hands.
Yeah.
Why not?
Something.
Okay. So, in order to remember these emotions better, I'm going to sing a song for you.
Yeah.
So you remember those five, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Can be without the mic. So you have to, you know, prickle your ears. Hey. That's good.
When I was a baby, I would wonder what was there beyond the stars. Who created all those things around me in this world of ours? As I got older, I would get some answers that made me feel okay for a while. But then something new came into my view and changed everything, or maybe just a few. So I just continued living and being a Jew. I ran from the fear, avoided the hurt, arrested my anger and took it to court. And when I felt sadness, I took it away. I dove into madness, and that's where I stayed. Very soon my life began to break like a house of cards. I was going down so fast, faster than flying darts. Selling my life for the $10 bill, imprisoned in my beliefs. Knowing that no one is going to help, but hoping that someone is.
then began the times of my salvation. In the dark I found my God. He and I would work on me together, recovering feelings I forgot. Years went by and I would start to think that I had finally arrived. But then someone new came into my view and changed everything and challenged my view. So now I'm standing right here and singing for you. So today I choose to feel fear, I choose to feel hurt, I choose to feel anger, I'm free as a bird. I choose to feel sadness, I choose to feel joy, the world and its madness, a wonderful choice. I choose to cry when I want, I choose to laugh when I feel like laughing. No matter what people say, I know I'm true to myself. I know I'm true to myself. I know I'm true to myself. I know I'm true to myself.
Yeah.
It's a good recap, right? Fear, hurt, anger, sadness, joy. So, to close, I'll tell you why all this is happening. You want to know why you're doing all those things? Okay, that's because of this baby. If it works. This is called Motivational Triad. And this video usually doesn't work, but this is about a shark trying to do three simple things, just like humans, just like any paramecium in the microscope or any other living creature on this planet. And this motivational triad is a combination of three biological instincts that every living creature on Earth has. Those three instincts are pleasure seeking, pain avoidance, and energy conservation. That's all. We mostly look for pleasure, which is usually food or sex, before everything else, the television and drugs came along, right? Okay, we usually avoid pain. By the way, emotional and physical pain are registered in the same place in the brain. So we avoid both of them. That's why we take meds and all that stuff, right? And we are designed to conserve energy because 40,000 years ago, if you don't find the food, you will die looking for it, okay? So we are designed by nature to survive. So this shell, this beautiful body that we're given, right, by nature, God, or whatever you want to call it, is designed to survive and pass the genes to the next generation, according to Dr. Doug Lyle. Okay, he's an environmental psychologist, right? So what I found is that in this body, in this beautiful house that I inhabit, there is a soul, for example. Probably most of us believe in this, right? Whatever you want to call what's inside me, what drives me, what arrived from the universe to inhabit this body, right, is something that tries to grow. So I'm in a constant battle against my biological urges and my spiritual urges, all right? So what I found for myself is that if I change this motivational triad into the transformational triad, I'm okay. I'm going to just remember that instead of discovering, seeking pleasure, I will discover pleasure by doing what? Expanding my energy, not conserving it. Stepping into my fear, doing something unknown. Has anybody exercised before in this room? How do you feel after exercising?
Better.
Because you expanded energy. But what did your body tell you before you started exercising? Don't exercise. My brain tells me for 5 years, I've been exercising for 5 years, 2 months, and 2 weeks, right? I'm counting those days because it's amazing. I'm still amazed. 4 days a week. Every single day it tells me, don't exercise. You know, you're going to be all right. But every time, amazingly, by accepting my pain, you know, I discover the new pleasure, you know, that no drugs or alcohol has ever given me. Just by doing these three simple things. So instead of conserving energy, expand energy, emotional or physical. Instead of avoiding pain, accept the pain. You don't even know, maybe it's going to be pleasure, not the pain. And I guarantee that you will discover it. You discover pleasure, okay? Take 100% responsibility for your life. Stop blaming others for your emotions. They're yours. I am not even here. I'm not here. And you're not here. You're just a reflection of light in my eyes. You're just my mirrors. Okay? So by taking 100% responsibility for myself, I have a chance at living a happy life and enjoying it. Make your life into an adventure.
boom, 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 boom. Do something.
Do something. Do something that you didn't do before. It doesn't have to be silly. But calling your mother after 20 years and saying you love her would be a good thing to do. Hugging your children at night is an interesting concept. You see what I'm saying? And this way, something happens in there. You become to feel profoundly happy. Okay, make your life into a project, right? Make it like an everyday assignment, a homework. Today I'm going to do this. Tomorrow I'm going to do this, right? The thing with this thing, though, is difficult because you need to have someone leading you. Leading you. Yeah. And that's why if you want to join me, and we have free trainings in our school if you want to, 5 times a year. I'll talk about it more. You know, but definitely having MKOs, more knowledgeable others, helps, you know, because they have already gone through where I haven't been. You know, it really helps. Okay? But keep thinking about life as an adventure. This amazing gift that we're given, gift of life, should not be used in vain. All right? This is my formula. This is what I use. I'm learning every day. I keep an open growth mindset. There's nothing, you know, there that I cannot learn. Okay? And I have never, and I will never learn everything. Okay, so I'll keep learning, and this is my formula that I stole from Dr. Bob Wright and changed a little bit, okay, because every day I'm in the present. Future doesn't exist. It's a left brain creation. It's not there. I'm here now with you in the right brain, feeling you my brothers and sisters. That's all. And if I keep it up front, I am guaranteed to succeed. Okay, it's going to be scary, painful. Most of you will reject me because your fear will not let you connect to me. But if you keep connecting, we're going to discover something unusual, something beautiful, something unexpected, all right? I'm learning to see myself first and others next accurately, without the projections of my mom, my dad, my teachers, you know? See you for who you are, in here and now, not in the past. You know, if I see my children in the past, I always be angry. They never put their clothes away. They never wash their dishes, you know, but I see them now. I'm giving them a chance every single day. And they're changing, trust me, because I'm changing, all right? With positive regard, not negative. I have enough negativity in my brain. It's built in me, in my biology. So I'm looking at you with positive regard consistently, which means I need to exercise, and unconditionally, just like God. So, this is the assignment for you, right? And this will help your neurons connect. This is the end of my presentation. Well, if you could do it until tomorrow night, it would be great. Okay, but definitely, if you want to remember something, connect with any of those participants right here, and this way you will have something to talk about, and your neurons will fire again, and this knowledge will go deep inside, and you will begin to use it practically. Okay, this is the website where you can go and sign up for free for the seminar that's coming up. Actually, this weekend we have one. So next one's coming in January, and then the next one is in March. I have one person who has gone through the seminar, she could share with you. Yeah, rightliving.com. I'm going to leave this slide up so you could write it down or take a picture of it with your new smartphone. Okay, and this way you guys will be okay. All right, so thank you very much for listening, and if you have questions, go right ahead. Okay. Thank you.
We're going to take about 20 minutes of questions so we can get into rebuttals right at 8 o'clock. Ram, when you're ready to start moderating, please
yes,
do so.
and the Don't first person
right
with
behind you.
Her hand up Ram. Is Ileana.
So what's your opinion about integrative medicine and how you connect it, perhaps? Because it's actually related.
Well, the thing is, 200 years ago, Americans found a way to make more money by diversifying and splitting the responsibilities of the workers. So if one gets sick, the other one can quickly replace him. And this type of business started spreading everywhere, including medicine. So if you go to podiatrists, but your problem is your heart, but it affects the legs, podiatrists will never know it. So integrative medicine is a way to go. Because now they're looking at the body as a whole thing. So I believe it's a good idea, but I know not enough about it to tell you anything about it. Okay, but it feels like a good move.
Can we turn off the projector so I can get a better view of you during the questions?
Yeah.
Okay, thanks. All right, next.
Go ahead, sir.
Yes. Where are you going, Rob? Rob?
Yes.
There or here?
Yeah, I see
you. Moderating
I also
or not?
See Carl. I
was there first, right?
First.
Okay, go ahead, sir.
Has there any been any long-term studies about this program, and let's say related to Alzheimer's? Is there some way to possibly prevent it from if you know about it, let's say, you know, is it like an organic thing or is there something wrong with the environment? What do you know about Alzheimer's?
Give him the microphone.
So I'm gonna rephrase the question. Bottom line, is this information connected to some way to treating Alzheimer's disease, or can we do something about it to, like, you know, postpone it or stop it or reverse it? Is that your question?
Okay.
The brain is a living mechanism, you know, and if you start exercising your brain by doing either memory games or anything like this, you actually start. It's a plastic, it's a muscle, you need to exercise it. So I don't know if you can reverse it, because the damage may be already beyond the repair point, but if you start eating right, exercising, and thinking right, I guarantee that the changes will be there, but I don't know if it can reverse, I don't have enough information on that.
All right, Doug Boucher and then Charlie.
Yeah, I'm over here.
Go ahead.
Okay, you know, at the end there, you were talking about being in the here and now. And I didn't hear the word mindfulness. Do you equate the here and now with mindfulness as being, mindfulness is supposedly being in the moment where you think either of what happened before the moment or something in the future. You only think about being in the moment. Do you equate your here and now with mindfulness?
I do. I was talking about mindfulness for the past hour. I just didn't use the word.
All right, Charles?
Yeah, Alan, your model of the human being said every person has five emotions, and the middle one is anger, meaning our normal operating status, homeostasis, is anger. That means everyone in the world is operating a large percentage of the time from anger for each other.
Close, very close. It doesn't mean it's just because it's written in the middle, it's there, but...
neutrality?
Well, 75% of humanity lives in a state of conformity and reactivity, which means we react to something, but we never assert ourselves enough. Okay? So anger is the best way to avoid feeling emotions and avoid taking responsibility for your actions. So I would say yes. I never looked at this way, but yeah, unfortunately, most of us live in anger because we want to cover up hurt and fear. Yeah, there's always periods of rest. Some of us, that's why we go and look for stuff and practice peacefulness and all that stuff, yeah. But hey, just scan your day today. See how many times you were angry because you were hurt.
I wasn't angry all day.
All right, good job. You don't have to. You don't have to. Go ahead.
All right. Tell us what was, what, you alluded to it a little earlier, but in the less than a minute, why did you find this stuff, and how has it helped you?
Mm-hmm. Very good. So why did you find this stuff, and how did it help you? So my yearning is to be seen, understood, known, and to make a difference in the world. Okay, I feel that my gift to this world is taking information that is complicated and simplifying it by keeping the substance of this information intact. So I was led to it by my higher power, if you want to say it, or my deepest yearning. So that's why I'm here sharing it with you, because I see no other benefits. I'm not getting paid.
I was wondering if you were working for the mall.
Okay, let the guy
name. Gary Levitt. I was wondering if you were working for the organization. Are you doing any more music? Because I love classical music. I get that from my dad.
So yeah, I play music once in a while. My wife is in my band, but we don't play as much. But yes, I have a music major, so we do play, but not as much.
All right,
Liliana. Oh, no, I don't believe it. It is.
What about religion?
Well, she's asking if I believe in life after life. Well, listen to this. Maybe it will help you understand what I believe. In the unlimited universe, there is unlimited number of possibilities. That's it. It means anything is possible. Period. Therefore, this life, if this life is all there is, well, actually, it is all there is for this life, life would be pretty boring. But, you know what I mean? If there is no beginning and no end, there must be something after that. It's just simple logic. The name of the band is Multivitamins. You can find us online.
I work with emotionally disturbed crisis.
Louder, please.
I'm wondering if you are trying to get a person to joy from the anger stage. Is there anything besides you talk about saying to yourself or having something tell you to say a certain statement to yourself? Are there any other techniques that you?
There are several techniques, and since I'm in the beginning of studying at Wright Foundation as a student myself, I have heard a lot, but I haven't integrated it in me to give you enough information with certainty. But definitely there's hundreds and hundreds of ways to take teenager to a place where he or she will express himself or herself responsibly. Okay, and one of the ways is naming your emotion. Name it to tame it is number one thing that works for everyone. The moment you name your emotion, you already tame it. You don't let your limbic system run you. You bring the higher consciousness in, and people don't know it. So just saying I'm angry, like anger management and negotiators use these techniques for years already. Okay, so there are many other ways, like gestalt therapy and everything like this, imagining, breathing. There's a lot of things that we could do to bring you back to that original hurt place. Or a fear place, so that teenagers will realize that they're not angry at the world, it's just their matrix talking, okay? And then they realize that they can be free from all those fears and angers from before, they will use the anger responsibly, and probably will revert to being more loving, because we are designed this way.
All right,
Peter, then Wes, that's up.
You said there are five emotions, but four out of the five are these negative ones.
Yeah.
So 80% of all
what's
our emotions.
What's going on?
Don't you think that's sort of lopsided?
That's right. Yeah, it's a bummer, isn't it? That we were led to believe that these four are negative. You know, this is a language. You know that you create your reality with language? Whatever you say to yourself is your self-fulfilling prophecy. If you say you're shy and go to the party and act shy, guess what will people think about you?
You're
shy. That you are shy. So those, if you change your thinking about these emotions being negative, you're going to enjoy being hurt. You're going to enjoy being sad. So they're not negative. They're just emotions. Hurt is not negative at all. At all. No.
People die of fear and anxiety.
No, it's still not negative. It's an emotion. It's part of your body, but we are so programmed to believe that they're negative that you cannot hear me right now because your brain tells you no way. There's no way. There must be some more good emotions. But trust me, they're all good. They're all good. Let's not call them negative and positive and see what happens. Okay?
Okay, Wes. Is God on our side?
Is God on our side? Did you see George Carlin, Religious is Bullshit? Religion is Bullshit? Did you see that? That like 1990 clip?
That was just a question.
No, yeah, he was joking about religion, so I wanted to quote him. God is you. So if you are on your side, God is too.
Who said that? Who said that?
George Carlin.
Okay, George Carlin.
George Carlin never said that, but I just wanted to.
I wanted to ask about school.
Louder, Don, please.
I wanted to ask about your school. Do you run it? The Wright Foundation. Now this. What does this Wright Foundation offer?
Wright Foundation offers a training in transformational leadership and social emotional intelligence, as well as coaching and entrepreneurial skills and sales skills, everything related to social and emotional intelligence.
You took a class.
I am taking classes right now, and I'm assisting there and I'm helping them out. I'm not a founder, I'm not getting paid for
black
this.
Shirt.
All right, how much does it cost to take a course at
the... Well, it depends. You know, the right foundations training, like foundations training is free of charge. It used to be $800, but it's free of charge right now for 2.5 days of immersion into social and emotional training. But if you want to sign up for a year, it's called Year of Transformation Program, then it's about $7,000 a year. If you want to do like salespersons, it's maybe $2,500 a year, but you get a lot with it. Trust me, it's much cheaper than any business course you'll ever take.
Okay.
Was that exhaustor? No, Tim Bolger.
I'd like to know what you think about a lot of what I've heard. I hear all the time through a group called Toastmasters International, especially with a lot of the motivational speakers. Your methodology today parallels almost verbatim a presentation I heard this afternoon by one of our motivational speakers in Toastmasters. Has anybody ever told you that you should become a motivational speaker?
Yes.
Thank you.
That's what I'm doing.
Thank you,
Peter. Yes, you said infants are in a state of fear. How can you prove this?
Infants are what? In a
state of fear.
Oh, they're in a state of fear?
I see happy babies all the time.
No, I'm talking about 0 to 6 months. Yes. They begin to smile and everything a little later than that.
Yes, this is what I mean.
Yeah, well, if you just put the baby into an MRI machine, I'm sure the fear centers will be just ignited. Imagine yourself being somewhere you don't know all the time, 100% of the time. How would you feel?
Can you prove it?
Nothing can be proven in this world. I cannot even prove my own existence. So don't worry about proving stuff right now.
Okay. All right. Again, can you turn?
All right. You mentioned that we inherit this collective memory, which, like Carl Jung. But if we all inherit collective memories, why do we have to learn to do like about 1,000 different things? Like, why do we all have to learn how to ride a bicycle if we all have this collective memory?
It's a motoric skill. I'm talking about emotional intelligence. You got to relearn something for the body. The brain remembers certain things to help it survive. Bicycle riding is a motoric skill. Some of us are better, some of us are worse. But you got to remember it, not learn it. You just need to recall it. And, of course, learn some new information. So, you know what I mean? We do have implicit memories built in into our wiring, neuronal wiring. But that doesn't include bicycle training there. Actually, it does, probably. If your dad rode bike really well, you have a chance to ride it faster or learn riding it faster than others. I'm almost 100% sure.
Riding a bike requires neural
Yeah, it does,
skills.
It does. So your point is that you should be able to ride the bike easily, right? If
yeah, and 1,000 other activities that a child has to learn.
Yeah. Yeah, but, you know, I learned to ride a bike by getting on the bike and riding it. And my wife didn't do it until she was 30, you know, so it depends. Really, who was in my generation, you know, and how their motor skills were.
Are you optimistic about the human race? What would you do about terrorism?
Are you optimistic about human race? What would I do about terrorism? Now, first of all, I don't believe in terrorism to begin with. Second of all, I cannot speak for human race. Second of all, according to somebody, we are the fifth civilization on this planet. So I'm not very optimistic, but deep in my heart, I believe we'll make it this time.
Okay, we had one over here.
What is the lifestyle that you said we're all yearning for? Can you describe that lifestyle?
That's right. We all have yearnings to realize our human potential. We know there is more in us. Then, you know, like every day, I feel like I could do more and something stops me. Some of us believe it's a drama triangle. We start burning our emotions uselessly. So everything, what drives us is the human yearning to realize human potential. That's what I believe is behind that.
Okay, Doug?
Yeah, I'd like to know,
did
your program that you're...
apostolizing for us.
Represent.
The other thing is, you haven't mentioned anything about the cost, but I would also like to know, do people with mood disorders attend your program, and has it helped them tremendously?
Well, we do a screening first. If you have a disorder that is a medical condition, we tend to direct you to a professional first. We do not take responsibility for severe mood disorders because, you know, this is based on positive psychology. So we try to help a person, but we will not, if we believe that you may get hurt more by doing it, we will suggest that you see a professional psychologist or psychiatrist first. That's right. Yeah, let me repeat this again. By approximately age 7, our brain frequency changes, and theta waves, specific waves, right, that keep the baby in a semi-hypnotic state, disappear. So we are downloaded information biologically in those first 7 years of life, and then those waves go away, and the learning becomes different. So this matrix is created in the first 7 years by connecting neurons quickly in the brain in certain ways, so we have an idea of what this world is like. And after 7, it's up to us to transform that matrix. But the foundational one sits there forever. And so matrix is a combination of neural connections, memories, emotions, everything that you have seen, felt, experienced, smelled, touched, and stored in your brain as part of your world existence, experience of the world. And then you react to life after 7 years old based on those memories and experiences stored in those neurons. But you can always rebuild and build on top of them and make a choice to act differently as an adult. And there are a couple of changes in the teenage years that are pretty profound. So, you know, I'm not going to go into that. But.
All right. Is there anyone here who hasn't had a question? All right, Bob, let's make that the last question
for
the
rebuttals.
We spoke about a motivational triad, but what do you say is the best way to motivate somebody to do anything?
Why is it the best way to motivate?
What
is the best way to motivate somebody to do that? Pain. There is no way to motivate anybody to do anything, really. It's in my case, you know, I was drinking and using drugs until I couldn't do it anymore, and I was in so much pain that my only choice was to do something different about it. Otherwise, I would create those reasons why not, you know, not to do it. So the best motivator is pain or love, you know, and pain could be fear or hurt. Okay.
All right, we're going.
How many people here have?
Let's first thank our speaker. Now we're going into the rebuttal period. Go on, Brad.
Yes, our rebuttal period. How many here have comments to make? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5? Is that all?
No, there'll be more.
Some people here might be inspired by the commentators. Okay.
So where do we go?
All right. Okay. Where do you go?
You go up there where you're standing.
Where do we go?
Line up by the rail, and then we'll go up.
But our first commentator will be Bill Wentz.
We're going to go about 3 minutes apiece. All right, four then.
I'm not going to talk about emotional intelligence so much as emotional stupidity. 1978, there came out a book called People of the Lake, Mankind and Its Origins by Roger Lewin and Richard Leakey. And they give a history of the human social and psychological makeup, which is based on a food-sharing society. This happened over about a period of 2 million years. To make a food sharing society work, you had to have two basic emotions. You had to have sympathetic emotions to compel each member of the band, of a hunter-gatherer band of about two dozen, to each other's aid. And you had to have aggressive emotions to take care of cheaters. And there's a brief paragraph which says that modern-day hunter-gatherer bands erupt an emotion against someone caught in cheating. Now, I see this at the bottom of just about every political movement. Everybody wants everybody else to get on his emotional wavelength. And I can say that about the Marxist movement. I guess composing my rebuttal in advance. But as long as we keep doing things on this type of emotional basis, a lot of things are going to get lost in the rush. The most powerful dictatorships, I'm thinking Soviet communism and South African apartheid, combined these aggressive and sympathetic emotions. But until we get beyond these emotions, we're going to be in our hunter-gatherer group. There is no market mechanism. We're not trained to emotionally allow to deal with the market mechanism. You have to transcend your market ingrained leanings. It's counterintuitive. And that's something I've learned here from you guys for about 30 years.
Next. 4 minutes, Sid.
Yeah. Actually, the emotions are part of the human condition. For instance, in primitive societies, what they usually done before they get ready to do certain things, like, for instance, harvesting their food, they usually would dance and chant together in order to get up the emotions up to a certain point where they go out and actually perform the duty and the things that they had to do in order for them to live, in order to hunt, to fish, or anything else, in order to go to war and things that have nature. For instance, we always have marches when we go to war to condition the emotions so people get to the position where they're interested in actually going to war. But we had a lot of different things happen throughout our history. What happened in Iraq, for instance. We were told over a long period of time that Saddam Hussein was a dictator, and they demonized him. Not that he wasn't a dictator, but they demonized him over a long period of time and told us that he had weapons of mass destruction. And they kept doing this over a period of time to condition you emotionally to go to war against them. Well, when Hans Blick went out and investigated, and he investigated almost everything with a fine-tooth comb and found no weapons of mass destruction. But yet we went to war because people were conditioned to do that. So if you could get the emotions working without any rational understanding of what is really happening. For instance, they compared Saddam Hussein to Hitler. How could he compare to Hitler? If you look at it rationally, Hitler lived in Germany and they had a highly industrialized society that was able to produce ships, planes, all the mechanisms of war. So how could you compare Hitler to Saddam Hussein. It doesn't rationally make any sense at all. But people are conditioned along those lines if they keep doing it. Hitler had done the same thing. He told the German people that they were superior, the superior race, and therefore they ought to own the world. And he didn't give them any proof, any scientific proof, but he kept saying it over and over and over again, and there were certain inferior races, and we had to get rid of these inferior races. And after a while, with enough conditioning, they used Pavlovian conditioning to the point where people start to believe it. So if you look at things just emotionally, you could be get all types of distorted views, and they can make you do things that you don't want to do. And this is one of the things we have to watch out for, because the human emotions should correspond to the actual conditions. And they don't correspond to the actual conditions, you have to question it. Like we say, we're a free society, but yet people aren't making enough to live on. We got so much unemployment, we got racism, we had a history of genocide against the Indians, against the African Americans, and things of that nature.
Okay.
But if certain people are living fairly well, they say, well, I'm feeling very well, and my emotions tell me that everything is correct.
Okay.
But you have to look at things objectively in order to understand things.
All right, next.
Thank you, thank you. Oh, guys, by the way, before I forget, if you need to leave earlier, you can put your email address if you'd like me to email you about upcoming events at RITE. Here's the mailing list. If you want to put yourself on, please do so.
I'll also put some contact information on the YouTube.
And if you want to, you can grab my card so you have my email address too and my phone number, okay? So just be, feel free to come and get one, okay?
Next speaker. Next. Our next speaker.
Next speaker.
Yeah.
I will be. Am I next?
Yes, you're next, Doug.
Do I get a microphone or I just talk?
You get a microphone.
Oh. Okay.
4 minutes.
I just want to say, for those who don't know me, I'm Doug. All right. I just wanted, as a follow-up to my question of Alex, our speaker, about mood disorders, and he said, well, we don't cater to those kind of people. I just want to say that I'm the kind of person that does. in my personal life, I'm known as a recovery support specialist. Actually, I'm trying to get credentialed by the state of Illinois as a recovery support specialist, but right now I'm aspiring to be one. Anyway, one thing I want to share with you is that in recovery for people with mood disorders, we have something called RAP, Wellness Recovery Action Planning. And within RAP is what we call a wellness toolbox. And there's also something called a daily maintenance plan. And just briefly, wellness toolbox are the things that you do daily to get happy. Or experience some level of joy, especially when you're down and out. And the thing I specialize in is wellness toolbox is I have a program where I can take your mood. Are you depressed? Are you frustrated? Are you anxious and sad? And I can recommend certain activities from a pleasant adult activity list that I have for you to get happy. Which kind of ties in with what our speaker was talking about, of getting to the level of joy and happiness. The other things that are in this RAP plan, we have support for you. When you're, people are encouraging you, will stand by you no matter what happens to you. If you give up hope in yourself, they will stand by you. We talked about advocacy, things that you seek on your own for your own wellness. Our speaker mentioned responsibility. That's a very important part of the RAP plan, that you take responsibility for your actions and that you seek how to manage your symptoms. We also throw in education, you know, expanding your mind about your illness, your medications, things like that, reading books that will help you. There was a book I found at the Salzer Library called The Chemistry of Joy that was on the shelf. Very interesting book. The other thing is that a lot of you people need is spirituality. And not that doesn't necessarily mean religion, but all of us, being body and soul, have an element of spirituality in us. And for each of us, it can mean different things. For some people, it can be power of a pyramid, crystals, whatever. But it, essentially, it's the moving spiritual moving force in your life. That's what counts. And actually, I work out in... I just recently got a job. I'm working out in Wheaton for NAMI Wheaton. No, actually, NAMI DuPage, I should say. And I'm working with people that come in, and they're not severely depressed, but they're mildly depressed. They need a little encouragement. So I sit with them for an hour and a half and try and provide a little incentive for them to get happy. Thank you.
Wow. Thank
you. Yeah.
All right.
I'll go.
Are we?
Okay.
Tim Bolger.
All right. It's Right Foundation completely parallels another program that I've heard about too, called the Landmark Education Forum, amongst other things. My biggest thing about getting well is, you know, with how many people have been helped by your program and by places like Landmark, I can show you hundreds who simply go to a good church somewhere in the morning or every day. You might find it a little crazy that tomorrow morning I'll be at Springbrook Community Church, of course in the production booth, but you will find that a lot of the trainings that these guys have are very parallel with the Christian faith. And the one thing I always look at is the numbers of these things. There's always going to be people helped with these types of programs, but if you really want to get where the rubber meets the road, you know, attend a good church and kind of take it seriously, because a lot more over time and a lot more change has been affected through the institutions like that, whether it be your synagogue or your things. You're with a community group, you have some accountability with some people, and you tend to work towards a common purpose, and that can be a very, very powerful influence. So if I would make any recommendations to anybody here, if you can't afford these programs or can't really do it, just get yourself to a good place of worship where you can feel comfortable with, and at least get into something that will help.
Is anybody else inspired here? Yes. Yeah. Don.
No space behind the podium today.
Oh,
okay. All right. Well, I kind of like to stand near the podium because that way I can set the paper down. See, I got notes that I refer to, and see that way I can put the paper down, and I don't have to hold the paper in my hand. And this thing is
just put it in the little. Okay, you got it.
Yeah. All right. All right. Is the microphone on?
Yes, it is.
Okay. All right. I think that, you know, I've been to things like this before, these kind of self-improvement things, and I don't really care for them very much. I think that I've become very skeptical of them. I think that people go, and I think mostly they're people trying to make a buck. You know, I think that so I don't really care for it. But
then why is it?
And I will say this, you know. Now you said in your presentation that people don't always make decisions based on emotion. All decisions people make are based on emotion. That's not true. People don't always make decisions based on emotion. And you know, people can and do make decisions based on logic. Now, you cited as an example, do we have bacon? Are you going to have bacon and eggs or cereal for breakfast? Well, in my case, there's no question about it. I'm going to have cereal for breakfast if I have a choice between cereal or bacon and eggs. Because, and the reason I do that is because cereal's lower in fat, and the doctor said I should eat less fat. And now, so it's not, so I'm not making that decision because, oh, well, I like cereal better, or I like bacon and eggs better. I'm making that decision because I'm trying to remain healthy. And so I think that's, if you want to be healthy, that's a logical decision to make. Now, Sid, you know, I agree with, by the way, as far as there's been a lot of statistics thrown around in this presentation tonight, but I just want to say that 57.9% of all statistics are made up. Okay, now, there's
one of them.
Right. Now, Sid, you know, I agree with you like 90% of the time. However, Hitler didn't create racism in Germany. Hitler's ideas about German superiority and so forth, and the idea that inferior races, those ideas existed before Hitler. And they existed. There were Germans that believed that before Hitler was even born. But although he didn't create it. Now also in terms of the United States. African Americans were treated real bad in this country, but it didn't go all the way to genocide. Not like what happened to the Jews in Europe with the Holocaust, because it wasn't. And genocide is when you try to exterminate an entire group of people based on their race or ethnicity. Black people have been treated real bad in this country for a long time, but it hasn't gone all the way to genocide like what happened to the Jews in the Holocaust or what happened to the Armenians in the Turkish Empire or what happened to or what's happened in many cases to the American Indians. And that's all I got to say about that.
Next speaker.
Come on, anyone else?
Yeah, we got more coming.
David Zucker.
The only thing I would say with regard to what Don said is, he's wrong on one point. What is slavery but genocide? I mean, yes, it's also an economic means to exploit people, but it's also a means to massacre a certain amount of them as well.
Slowly. All right.
All right.
Charlie, see here.
Well, let's thank our speaker. That was a good presentation. Yeah. We're given a lot to talk about here. It'll be eclectic and not too much tonight. As I vaguely recollect, and you can get any figure number you want to put into this, I think there's about 18 primary major personality theories. I don't know where the rights fit in, if they've given a name to it. Most psychologists, they use the term eclectic, like my presentations are, and in terms of assessing the human situation, they draw on each of them. They each have some validity and some questionable elements. What we heard tonight, I heard a lot of childhood. Anytime you find a lot of our behaviors attributed to what happened when we were children is basically a Freudian approach. Usually they end up, amazingly enough, and there's some validity to this, the child is the father of the man, but they say we're completely formed in terms of individuals no later than 5 or 7 years old. And I think I'm learning even at my stage of life, learning many things that I think I didn't do before. So I don't know if, and also if we're all done at the age of 5 or so, why would I sign up for your course, Al? In terms of the recommendation of going to church, to achieve sanity, I've got to draw the line on. I don't know if going to church is an act, is a sane act.
For some you people know, it is, Charlie.
For some people it is,
complete
Charlie.
Complete sanity. I would be careful here. I don't want to offend the religious community out there, but
we already
if
did.
You benefit by this, you know. Regarding a life coach, I feel I've been serving in that capacity for a number of years with you guys without much success.
Because and you're giving us the wrong advice.
Matter of fact,
Charlie.
Yeah, I've been a complete and abject failure in trying to redirect their lives. But seriously, also an emotion, I believe in searching my mind and technology of psychology, an emotion is tied, is a thought process tied with a physical connection. And that what defines an emotion as opposed to a thought. It's a response that has a physical connection to it. And that's what makes it different from other types of situations, in that you get into this mind-body, the Cartesian dichotomy, and things like that. But anyhow, thanks a lot. I enjoyed it very much. You know, I don't think I'm going to get to church tomorrow, though. Thank you.
Good.
Okay.
Our final rebuttal.
We got another one.
Our speaker.
Well, here, maybe.
There's another rebutter.
Well, Tim. Charlie.
Double right.
Sorry, Charlie. Only my best tasting tune yet to meet Starcast.
This is the first time.
Well,
here.
Chuck is
from
a
the other place?
Hard act to follow. For like 3 weeks now. And I was the one, Gary Levitt, who mentioned the questions of terrorism. Nice to get my name mentioned, L-E-A-V-I-T-T, to be a little footnote in history, if not some of the major players as some of our other people here. Years ago, when I got interested in psychology because of my own problems, there was an interesting book called Free to Feel by Jerome Liss, L-I-S-S, a psychiatrist. That might not be easy to find, but he had an interesting thing there. He thought that the problems were not so much how you feel, but what you're not able to feel and express. And of course, Wayne Dyer, the late Wayne Dyer, wrote many books on self-help, like 41. And Deepak Chopra has written about 65, and I think his daughter wrote one or two. And there's always a book on the bestseller list about helping yourself. And how much can you get out of one book, or even this $7,000 course in a year? So I've had a lot of bad experiences in the mental health care system. I used to live in a place called the Grassmere in Uptown. And I can't get into a lot of how I got there and how long I was there, but I talked on the phone to Celeste Jensen, the director, who I thought was nice, and I told her my mother and sister smoke. I tried to get them to stop, but she thought they were doing it to control their weight. My mother was doing it to control her weight, which is nonsense. And I told her it was presumptuous to say that, and she hung up on me. Years in the experience of being a mental health professional. My first hospitalization at Illinois Masonic in 1969 cost my parents a significant amount. The late Earl Norman Solon, Earl Solon, S-O-L-O-N, his name means noble, wise lawgiver. Dr. Harold Appel, my first therapist, recommended by Dr. Dorothy Nielsen, my high school psychologist in Dallas North. Dr. Appel said Dr. Solon was as good as they come in the Chicago area. He thought I was schizophrenic. He never really explained what that was. He was evil, dictatorial, tyrannical. Someday I'd like this to get to the public, but I'm not sure exactly how to administer it. Somebody suggested I blog, but I don't know how to do that. And I really don't love writing, because I didn't like writing assignments in school. It would not be easy for me to write a book. Maybe someday I'll give my own talk here. I've been coming off and on for years. How much more time do I have?
Two more minutes or so, so go ahead.
I've occasionally called Milt Rosenberg. He's found a new home on WCGO on 1590. He's on Monday through Friday from 4 to 6. I never was comfortable, but he was very nice. He said he's been doing this for 30 years and he's still nervous. He was nice to give me some encouragement. So I got to tell the papers, they used to have, maybe in both papers, sometimes a trip of the highlights of the radio. So I'm not paying attention to what's on his show. I should get into the habit. It's nice if they have, along with the TV listings, the highlights of radio shows, because Milt at 90 years old is going strong. I went from Jewish to being an atheist to being skeptical about religion, but I'm hopeful that there's something more than this. The problem with the atheists is they know they're going down in history. Nobody's going to get Freud, Christopher Hitchens, Sam Harris, Richard Dawkins, Daniel Dennett, Bill Maher. Most people never write a book or have a TV show, but I'm skeptical that there has ever been a close encounter with God. But I hope there's a life after death, I hope there's an ultimate meaning, and I hope there's an ultimate source of love and justice, because it's hard to live without those things. We're not meant to be, we're not set up to be either objective about the future after death, or disinterested, meaning objective, or uninterested, meaning not caring. I thought over the years the only hope for our family is winning the lottery, but I decided not to play. The odds are even worse now in the big game. It's like 1 in 280 million. I thought in my teens and to health, ecology, and fulfillment are the three values everybody should live by, and I think it's still true. But usually when I thought about lecturing, which I often did, I would talk to people who believed me. And I gotta appreciate the fact of evil in this world, and I can't reason with everybody. Believe me, I've tried to reason with therapists, and they're among the hardest to reason with that anybody I've known. Dan Gilbert said, he gave a talk at Northwestern once, he said, if you make 75 grand a year, if you make more than that, you really don't get happier. But I think a flaw in that is that if you make a lot of money in the lottery, you don't have to keep it all. If you make millions of dollars, well, you can't know how inflation will be affected in the future, how long you'll live, but you can be a charitable and be a philanthropist and get more pleasure out of that than you could if you just made 75 grand a year. I didn't make this point when he was in Northwestern. I've enjoyed it. Sometimes I'm the one who makes a statement after a lecture, and they sometimes don't always appreciate that. I try my best. I saw Dr. Quentin Crisp after a lecture at the Unitarian Church near the University of Chicago. He was in the building, and he was Don Cherkel's doctor. I said something about how conscientious I was that made him laugh. I said, I'm like a centipede trying to put his best foot forward. So let us hope I overcome any feelers of imperfection and that I did the right thing, and I helped in a little way the progress of civilization, and Tim is helping me wrap up. Thank you so much for listening, and I look forward to coming again.
With one request for our speaker, if you could do that song again at the end of your little wrap up there.
All right. So sad, hurt, and well, not scared. I'm sad. I'm hurt a little bit. Angry too. Yeah, but mostly sad. But at the same time, very joyous. You know, emotions are different from states. There is a state, like a mood, you know, happiness is a state, you know, pride, something like this. But emotions are short-lived. They're biological reactions, like you said, right? And I don't have to, you know, be sad longer than I have to be. I don't have to be angry or joyous or scared or hurt longer than I have to be. The thing is, if I keep suppressing those emotions, I will waste my brain's valuable energy. And it already has only 40 watts of electricity. Okay, so I want to really use it wisely. So every gentleman who spoke here had a valid point, and I enjoyed that. You know, what I noticed, though, that nobody was in here and now. Everybody was in their story. Nobody used I and everything, but it's not required. You know, I can accept you today for what you are, have my feeling, and move on. All right, I'm not gonna live in the resentment of you not accepting me today, you know, and or not understanding what I said, because I just presented to you an hour ago that 95% of what I say will be forgotten.
Write it down.
You know what I mean? So if you write it down, you have a higher chance to remember it if you review it within 24 hours. So, you know, basically some of the things that you hit on, I already explained in my lecture. You know, like I said, I'm a part of a 12-step fellowship where we believe in a higher power, and I go to church every Sunday. So I did not deny the necessity of church for some people, right? I also did not throw out much statistics. I was very careful with statistics, you know, and I love your joke about 59.7. It's awesome. And this guy told me 5 out of 4 people don't understand fractions, you know. I love it. I love it. You know what I mean? So, which brings us to the landmarks view of life. You mentioned landmark education. I was there too, and I took a couple courses there. Life is empty and meaningless. and it's up to us to create the meaning for it, you know. And logic, as opposed to choosing the cereal, for example, over bacon and eggs, does not make you like cereal until you convince yourself you do. So your logic does help you survive. And I did not say we stopped learning. I did not say that. You keep learning, you keep transforming. I was talking about formative years, something that is foundational. So thank God our brain is a muscle. Thank God it has neuroplasticity. Thank God we have God, you know what I mean? Because everybody on this planet has a choice to choose whatever meaning of life you want to apply to it and enjoy being it, okay? So I definitely appreciate this opportunity to share and hear you too, you know, because it's just amazing being here and now with the people who are willing to learn more. You know, and I'm a lifetime learner, so I really appreciate you guys sharing this evening with me, and again, just, you know, giving me the opportunity to share my soul with you. So thank you very much.
Can we hear the song again, please?
Yeah, song. Let me just sing it a cappella, right?
Okay, okay.
Without the guitar. Okay, it's, and I will tell you as a, you know, like more like a rap, right?
Oh, okay.
When yes. I was a baby, I would wonder what was there beyond the stars, who created all those things around me in this world of ours. As I got older, I would get some answers. They made me feel okay for a while, but then something new came into my view and changed everything, maybe just a few. So I just continued living and being a Jew. I'm 50% Jewish. So I ran from the fear, avoided the hurt, arrested my anger and took it to court. And when I felt sadness, I pushed it away. I dove into madness, and that's where I stayed for a while. But very soon my life began to break like a house of cards. I was going down so fast, faster than flying darts, selling my life for a $10 bill, imprisoned in my beliefs, knowing that no one is going to help, but hoping that someone is. You know? And then began the time of my salvation. In the dark I found my God. She and I would work on me together, recovering feelings I forgot. Years went by, and I would start to think that I had finally arrived. But then someone new came into my view and changed everything and challenged my view. So now I'm standing right here and singing for you. That I choose to feel fear, I choose to feel hurt, I choose to feel anger. I'm free as a bird. I choose to feel sadness. I choose to feel joy. The world and its madness are wonderful toys. I choose to cry when I want. I choose to laugh when I feel like laughing. No matter what people say, I know I'm true to myself. I know I'm true to myself. Thank you.
Thank you, Alex. You have been true to yourself, and I hope that we can all be a little truer to ourselves and to the God who makes us.
And you can all sing right. The song with me, too.
Could you sing it in Russian?
Okay.
This is for you, actually, in... So basically, instead of the word hands, use the word emotions. Okay? So this is a karaoke.
This is the world we live in. These are the hands we're given. Use them and let's start trying to make this a place worth living in. These are emotions we're given. Use them
thank you, and I hope to see you all sometime in the future. I hope in the near future.